I'm going to ask you to take your Bible now and turn with me, if you will, to Psalm 51. Psalm 51, that's right. Psalm 51, and we'll be eventually looking at the entire psalm, but to begin with, I want us to read just one verse, and I think it'll help us in our thinking this evening. Psalm 51, let's do two verses. I said one. Let's do verses 12 and 13. Psalm 51, verses 12 and 13. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. That, in essence, is what we're going to talk about tonight, the theme of those two verses. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for blessing us. Thank you for this time we have together. Lord, help us as we look into your word. Give us an understanding. Guide us by your spirit into all truth. And forgive us anything that would stand in the way of your working. Once again, we pray for souls. If anyone hears us tonight or will listen later who doesn't know you as Savior, we pray for that soul salvation. Those of us who know you, we pray, Lord, revive us again. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to talk to you a minute about the Old Testament. The Old Testament, 39 books of the Old Testament, is largely made up of stories. Now, the book of Psalms is not a book of stories. It's a book of songs, but largely made up of stories. And these stories are not just stories. They're stories about real people. The events actually happened to them. And they are recorded for us, for our edification, to help us to learn, help us to grow. So many prominent characters in the Old Testament. One of them that always stands out, and certainly not the only one, but one is David. Now, David was a remarkable fellow. He started out, we first meet him when he's a young man. A lot of people tell the story, make it sound like he was still a little boy, and that's not quite true. But he was a young man, and he becomes the champion. He's a shepherd watching his father's sheep, but he becomes the champion of the nation of Israel when he defeats Goliath. But David was quick to tell Goliath and everybody else he didn't do that by himself. He did that with God's help. And God calls David a man after mine own heart. He's also called in one place the sweet psalmist of Israel. And David lived a remarkable life where God guided him every step of the way. But you know what happened to David? Same thing that happens to a lot of us. He got a little complacent, and his heart got cold, and he began to turn away from the Lord. Now, outwardly, he didn't look much different. Outwardly, he put on a good show. But inside, things weren't like they used to be, and he wasn't as close to the Lord as he had been. And we think of David's great victories, but we also think of David's great sin. Now, did he ever sin more than once? Absolutely. Absolutely. There's no question about that. It's been said of David that he kept short-term accounts with God. What does that mean? It means, yes, he sinned, and when he did, he quickly got right with God again. But this time, it wasn't so short. This time, he had lusted after another man's wife. He took her. They were immoral. And a child was conceived. Then David tried to cover it up. Instead of confessing and being open about it, he tried to cover it up. And as he tried to cover it up, matters got worse. You know, that's always what happens. When we try to cover our sin, things get worse. If you tell a lie, and I'm not accusing you of lying, but if you tell a lie and then somebody begins to discover it, you often tell another one to cover up the first one. And I tell people all the time, I have to tell the truth because I can't remember what I've told to who. So I just have to tell the right truth because I'd never be able to cover it up. But the fact is, David tried to cover it up. And one day, Nathan, the prophet, and I've wondered about Nathan. There's a couple of Nathans in David's story, and I've wondered exactly what his relationship is, other than he was a prophet. Nathan came to David and he told David a story. He said there was a wealthy man. He had flocks and herds. And then he had a next door neighbor who had just one little lamb. And he loved that little lamb. That lamb was not part of a flock. That lamb was their family pet. And the lamb slept in the house with the family, and the children loved the lamb. And the wealthy neighbor had a guest come in, and he wanted to serve a great meal for his guest. And so instead of going out to his flocks and herds where he had an abundance, he took his neighbor's one little lamb and prepared that for the meal for his guest. When Nathan told that story to David, David got angry. And he said, "The man that has done this shall surely die." And Nathan looked the king in the face and said, "Thou art the man." That's you. That's you. And David's heart smote him. And David realized he was the man. It wasn't somebody else whose sin had hurt his heart. It was his own. David confessed his sin right away. But can I share something with you? The Bible says very plainly, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he, the Lord, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that's true. You can count on that. You can rest assured in that. You confess your sins, God forgives you. But that doesn't mean there are no consequences. I could create some scenarios for you, but I think you understand. There can still be consequences to sins, even sins that have been forgiven. And that was true in David's case. That little child that Bathsheba killed, I'm sorry, I said that wrong, that Bathsheba conceived, I meant to say, died. David had arranged for Uriah's murder, really, arranged to have him killed in battle. And David's sin confronted him. And the child died. And there were other problems. David had many children, and they began, some of them, not all of them, to rebel against him. One of his sons committed incest. Another son killed that first son out of revenge, and then tried to take over the throne. There were consequences to the sin. But David came to the point where he brought it all before God. And he confessed his sin. And Nathan the prophet spoke to David again and said, "The Lord hath put away your sin. You will not die." David went on. He was not as great as he had been before, but he went on. And one preacher said he wrote some of the sweetest psalms after that time. After his heart had been broken, after his will had been broken, and after he gave his heart anew to the Lord. And that's what Psalm 51 is. Psalm 51 is David's prayer of repentance. But what does that have to do with you and I sitting here? That's a great story from millennia ago. What does that have to do with you and I sitting here in Delray Beach in 2023? Much. We have this series of meetings coming up. We have a preacher coming in, and I'm sure he's going to do his job. He's going to do a great job. But if we want to see God work, we need to pour a lot of prayer into this. I trust you've already been praying. And we need to first pray for ourselves. And we need to pray and ask God to work in our hearts. And then he'll work in other hearts. So the question has come up. Are we having a revival meeting or are we having an evangelistic meeting? And I mentioned this more. What's the difference? The difference is this. A revival meeting is for God's people, for those who are Christians, to be revived, to come back to God the way they were when they first got saved. You remember when you first got saved? You probably do. And you remember how it was the most wonderful time in your life? And you remember how so many things were new for you? I mean, you'd read the Bible and it was just live and living for you. You'd go to church and you just loved going to church. You loved being with God's people. You loved singing the hymns. And if anything was happening, you wanted to be part of it. That was my experience. I got saved on a Sunday night. I've told this here before, and not too long ago. And Sunday night, somebody said to me, hey, you coming to Bible study Tuesday night? Never been to a Bible study in my life. And I said, yeah, I'll come to Bible study Tuesday night. Tuesday night, somebody said, hey, are you coming to prayer meeting Wednesday night? Never been to a prayer meeting in my life. I said, yep, I'll come to prayer meeting Wednesday night. Wednesday night, somebody said, you coming to visitation Thursday night? I didn't even know what visitation was, folks. I didn't know what they were talking about. But if these folks were doing it, I wanted to be part of it. I said, yeah, I'll be here Thursday night. Thursday night, somebody said, you coming to teen group Saturday? Yeah, I'm coming to teen group Saturday. I was disappointed they didn't have anything on Friday. And then it was Sunday again. And you know what? I've been doing it ever since. Ever since. But have I always had the same thrill that I had in the beginning? Not always. Not always. Has it always been as new and fresh? Not always. Have sometimes things become routine? Yeah, that happens. What do? Will you come back? You come back to where you were when the Lord first worked in your heart and when you first trusted Him. You remember the story that Jesus told about the prodigal son? You do. Father had two sons, and the younger son decided to leave home and chose to leave his father. And he made a decision to take his inheritance early and go and live a completely independent way. There'd be no limitations on him. He had enough money to do whatever he wanted to do. And all the things he had grown tired of at home would no longer be a part of his life. But the day came when he ran out of money. And when he ran out of money, he discovered he ran out of friends also. And that's so often the case. I saw something like that. I wouldn't call the fellow I'm about to talk about a prodigal. But I saw something like that when I was teaching high school years ago. And there was a young man who wasn't very popular. But his father was a wealthy man. And so this young man came to school, high school student, drove himself to school every day in a beautiful, brand new Pontiac Firebird, gold outside, gold inside, beautiful car. But he didn't have many friends. He had money. And so he would buy things for the other high school students, the other students there, trying to buy friends. And he would take them places in his car, and if they went somewhere, he always paid the bill. And so he always had a group of people around him. And one day he came to school. He didn't come in that beautiful Pontiac Trans Am. He came in a van. And I said, where's the Trans Am? He said, oh, I traded it for this van. I said, why did you do that? I can take more friends with me in the van. But they weren't really his friends. They were his friends as long as he had the money. They were his friends as long as he was paying the way. I thought it was very sad, to tell you the truth. I really did. That's the way this prodigal son was. When he ran out of money, he ran out of friends. And he began to do things that he would never have done previously. They would have been unthankful to him before, but he had to do them in order to survive. That wasn't how it was supposed to be. That's not how he had it planned. It's not what he dreamed about. Then he began to remember how it was back home, and he remembered even the hired help in his father's house had better lives than he was having. So he decided to go home, not to come back home as a son, but to go home and just see if his dad would hire him. He could get a job, make some money. He was tired of living in the pig pen, and he literally was living in the pig pen. But when he got home, he was not welcomed as a hired hand. He was welcomed as that long-lost son. And that's the way God is. When we'll come back to Him, we come to Him, and He welcomes us home as a son, as His child. He welcomes us back home. I've had many conversations with people who, in essence, have said something similar to me, the stories I've just told. They say something like this: I know the Lord. I know I've been saved. but I've gotten away from God. I've made some choices that haven't been right, and I need to come back to God. Reminds me of the song by William J. Kirkpatrick. It's actually probably my favorite invitation hymn. We don't sing it here a lot. We do sometimes. But let me just share a little something personal with you. The songs we sing, we don't always sing my favorite songs. If we did, we'd sing the same songs all the time. You'd get tired of them. We try to choose songs that fit the theme of the service. William J. Kirkpatrick wrote this: I've wandered far away from God. The paths of sin too long I've trod. I've wasted many precious years. I'm tired of sin and straying, Lord. My soul is sick. My heart is sore. Now I'm coming home. My strength renew. My hope restore. Lord, I'm coming home. Then I've heard people say things like this, and recently, I don't understand how we as a society, I don't understand how we as a country are in the condition we're in. It was Gordon Jensen who wrote, wars and strife on every hand and violence fills our land. How did we get here? You may remember, some of you, younger folks probably won't, but some of you may remember the name Alexander Solzhenitsyn. He grew up in the Soviet Union. He was a man of the many accomplishments, but he's best known as a writer. He wrote fiction stories, but in them he spoke about the humanistic and atheistic philosophies that he believed ruined his nation. Solzhenitsyn said this: if I were asked to formulate as concisely as possible what was the main cause of the ruinous revolution that swallowed up some 60 million of our people, I could not put it more accurately than to repeat, men had forgotten God, and that's why all this happened. Do you know what I think? That was Solzhenitsyn years ago. I'm going to tell you, if I could sum up what's happening and what has happened in our society, it'd be the same thing. We've forgotten God. We've left him out. We started that a long time ago. It's not a new thing. I was still in school, and I still remember when they said we could no longer start school with prayer, and we could no longer start school with a Bible reading. I remember that so well. And did it make a difference? It certainly did. It certainly did. So as a society that has lost its way, or as an individual heart that's lost its way, the cause of each is the same, and the cure for each is the same. A society that has abandoned God, or the individual that has ignored God, perhaps intentionally or perhaps unintentionally, perhaps just through negligence, in both cases, they need to say, I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. But like that prodigal, if we do that, you'll find arms of love open wide. The cause is the same. The cure is the same. We need to come back to God. But how? How do we do that? Now, I want to share with you some things here in Psalm 51 and in other passages of Scripture that I think will help us to understand that all. And we'll understand how to have a revival and an evangelistic meeting. Revival, again, is for God's people, when God's people get on fire for God once again. An evangelistic meeting is where we reach out to the lost and we see people saved. It doesn't have to be an either-or situation. It can be both. But let me help you with that thought. The revival needs to come first. In Acts 13, Paul was preaching in a synagogue, and he reminded the people there of God's working in the history of Israel, and he told them about David. He said, they, the people of Israel, desired a king, and God gave them Saul, the son of Kish, of the tribe of Benjamin, by the space of 40 years. And when he had removed him, this is Paul talking about Saul, and when God had removed him, Saul, he raised up under them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Of this man's seed hath God, according to his promise, raised unto Israel a Savior, Jesus. That's a promise, a covenant God made with David, that his son, His descendant would be the Messiah, would be the king. If you read in Matthew and Luke the genealogy of Jesus, you will find that Joseph was a descendant of David, but Joseph was not the father of the Lord Jesus. If you'll read again, you'll find that Mary was also a descendant of David. And so literally, the Messiah, the Christ, the Lord Jesus, is the son of David. And he was called that on many cases. One day he's walking down a street and a man called out to him, said, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." There's so many wonderful things that we find in God's word. And when we talk about David, God looked into his heart and he saw something there that the Lord found worthy to using him and to becoming a standard for all the kings of Israel that followed. Did you know that? All the kings after, there were 19 kings of the northern kingdom, Israel, 19 kings of the southern kingdom. And they're all referred or compared, I should say, back to David. You'll read that it says he did that which is right in the sight of the Lord, as did his father David. Now, it might have been his grandfather's great-grandfather, but he's compared back to David. Or, more often, it will say, he did evil in the sight of the Lord and walked not in the ways of his father David. But in every case, compared back to David. David was humble and he waited for the Lord's time in his life. And God used him to unite the tribes of Israel into one nation. And God used him to write some of the most beautiful words ever to come from a pen. If you question that, think of Psalm 23. Some of the most loved words in the history of mankind. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Yet for all this, David was still just a man. He was human. He possibly wrote Psalm 119, we don't know that for sure, but verses 9 to 11 say, wherewithal, and with what way, how am I going to cleanse my way? Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? The answer, by taking heed thereto according to thy word. With my whole heart have I sought thee, oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hidden mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. Yet for all this, David drifted. And it wasn't one single act that turned his heart. It was a series of decisions that he made that he knew weren't right. And that's usually how it is. A person doesn't usually go from just living a wonderful Christian life to, in an hour, ruining it all. It's usually a progression. It's usually a series of bad decisions that people have made. And David knew that some of the things he did were wrong. Deuteronomy 17:17. Listen to this. The Lord commanded this for kings. Listen, neither shall he, the king, multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply unto himself silver and gold. And yet David married Michal, Abigail, Ahinoam, Maacah, Haggith, and Eglah, six wives, and that's before Bathsheba. Seven wives altogether. Now, there's a story, of course, behind each one of those. We don't have time to go into all that. And David could give you a reason for each one of those. If you asked him, he'd reason it out logically. Michal left him for another man. Abigail was a widow. The story behind each one. But God said that the king should not multiply wives unto himself, that his heart turned not away. David ascended to the throne. He became a great king in many ways. But as we said before, David's heart began to turn away a little bit at a time. And it may have been so gradual that David himself didn't notice at first. Then again, could be that like so many other people, David was fully aware that he was doing wrong, but it was what he wanted. And after all, it can't be all that bad if it makes me happy, can it? David's great sin was a natural progression of where he had been and what he had done and the decisions that he made. He was a married man. He had an affair with a married woman. And we've already talked about the result. So then he becomes convicted. And David writes this song. In verse 1, he begins by praying, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions." Notice what he does. He confesses. He doesn't make excuses. He doesn't say, "Lord, you know, I've made some mistakes, but it wasn't my fault." He doesn't say that. He doesn't say, "Lord, you see, you understand how it is. You know, I'm just dust." And he didn't make any excuses at all. He just admitted, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions." And he knew that he needed his heart to be cleaned. And so he says in verse 2, "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." Watch verse 3, "For I acknowledge my transgression." That's where it starts. I acknowledge my transgressions. I admit my sin. I'm not hiding anything. I'm not covering anything up. I bring it all before you, Lord. I acknowledge my transgression. My sin is ever before me. I can't forget about it. Verse 4, "Against thee and thee only have I sinned." My sin is a sin against God. Had he sinned against Uriah, he had. Had he sinned against Bathsheba, he had. Had he sinned against his other wives, he had. Had he sinned against the people of Israel, he had, because he violated their trust. But he says, when the final analysis comes, "I've sinned against God." And this is what we have to come to realize. All sin is a sin against God. "Against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest." Lord, you're right to judge me, and I acknowledge it. Whatever's coming my way, I deserve it. Then he says in verse 5, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." He wasn't saying anything bad about his mother there. What he's saying is, "I was born a sinner. I've been this way all my life." And any of us who are honest are going to have to say the same thing. Verse 6, "Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, in the hidden part. Thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop." Hyssop is that brush-like plant that the priest would use, and we talked about this morning, that he would use on the Day of Atonement when he would go in to the Holy of Holies with the blood of the sacrificed ram, and he would dip hyssop in the bowl of blood and sprinkle it on the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies to make atonement for the people's sin. That's what David's talking about when he says, "Purge me with hyssop. Make the blood atonement for my soul. And I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow." Isn't that a beautiful thought? "Wash me, I shall be whiter than snow. I've sinned, and my heart has become dirty, but wash me, and I'll be clean again." That's what John's talking about when he says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Verse 8, "Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice." What's he talking about, bones that you've broken? Well, that which you had to do to me to get me back. It's said that in biblical times that shepherds who took care of little lambs, sometimes they'd have a lamb that would wander off, would stray, and it would do it habitually. So the shepherd, to save the lamb, because he knows this lamb out there by himself doesn't have much chance of survival. So he would get the little lamb, and he would take his shepherd's rod, and he would break the lamb's leg, and then he would bind it up so carefully and tenderly so that it could heal. And then he would take that little lamb and put it on his shoulders and carry him until that leg could heal, and he would walk again. But they say that after that, that lamb would never wander away again, would always stay near the shepherd. That's what David's talking about here when he says, "Make me to," verse 8, "make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins, blot out my iniquity." Verse 10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God." renew a right spirit within me. I said earlier, remember how you felt when you first got saved? I remember one young man, teenager in our church years ago, he called me up one Saturday morning. He said, you know, I've gotten saved. He says, I just feel so clean. And that's exactly what David's talking about here. You do feel clean. You feel like you've got a new start on life because you have. Create in me a clean heart. Oh God, renew a right spirit within me. You're just right with God and you know it. And you want to be that way. And you want to walk that way every day. Verse 11, he says, cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Going back to the story of David, King Saul was the first king of Israel, and Saul started out as a good king. And when Saul was anointed king, God filled King Saul with his Holy Spirit. But Saul, as David would do later, Saul got off track. He got away from God. He got caught up in himself. He got caught up in his own importance and put his will ahead of God's will. And he came to the point where Samuel comes to him and says to Saul, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness is as idolatry. And God said, I'm not going to have Saul to be king anymore. And he called David, and David was anointed to be king, and the Holy Spirit was taken away from Saul and given to David. Now, in those days, in the Old Testament time, the Holy Spirit would come upon people and leave people and come upon people and leave people. One of the greatest cases of that is Samson. You know, Samson was probably a very strong man anyway, but he did his great feats of strength, if you read his story, when the Spirit of God came upon him. And yet Samson had gotten caught up in himself and in his own pride. And Samson did a series of things, not one thing, a series of things that violated his vow as a Nazarite. And he violated God's will in his life. And when the Philistines finally captured him and bound him up, he thought he would fight them off like other times. But he didn't know, the Bible says, that the Spirit of God had left him. And he was captured. What David is saying here is this. Lord, please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Now, you're a New Testament believer. You don't have to believe that, because since the day of Pentecost, believers in Christ have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. He's not going to leave you. He's not. Read John 14 and John 16, and you'll learn all about it. He's not going to leave you. But Paul tells us you can grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And while you will not lose the Holy Spirit, you can lose the power of the Holy Spirit. While you will not drive away the Holy Spirit, you'll lose some of his blessing. So David says, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with a free spirit. Let me feel like I did when I was close to you. Let me feel like I did when my heart was right with you. Let me feel like I did when you first saved me. Let me feel like I did when all I wanted to do was live for you. Folks, that's what revival is. That's it. That's it. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit. That's what a revival is. When God's people who are already born again, when God's people get back right with God and they're close to him once again. When they say, like the old song years ago, Christ is all I need, all I need, all I need. Verse 12 again, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy free spirit. That's the revival. The next verse, we read it in the beginning, verse 13, that's the evangelistic meaning. Then will I teach transgressors thy way, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Look at what he says. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Sinners shall be converted. Sinners shall be saved. When? Then. When's then? What happens? What's the predicate of that? What has to happen first? What happens to happen first is restore unto me the joy of my salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit. That has to happen first. When the revival comes, then we teach transgressors their ways. Then sinners are converted. That's what he's saying. I want to see people saved, preacher. I do too. You know something better than that? God does too. More than anything. I want to see our country get back on the right track. Well, for that to happen, there's only one way for that to happen. That's for people to be on the right track. And for people to be on the right track, they've got to be right with God. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways. Sinners shall be converted unto thee. Verse 14, he says, deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. You know, when you're right with God, you've got a whole new sound to your singing. And it may not be that you're the greatest vocalist in the world. It just may be that your heart's so full of joy, it comes out. 15, O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. I don't know about you, but when I first got saved, I wanted to tell somebody else so they could get saved. I did. I didn't know how to tell people about the Lord. I didn't. I didn't have any training in the beginning. I didn't know how to present the gospel. I didn't know anything about preaching. I didn't know any of that. But I knew what I could do. I could go tell people, say, hey, you know what? I went over here to this church and I got saved. Why don't you come over with me and you get saved? Did anybody do that? Yes. Yes. I remember so well, I was a senior in high school. I remember so well a fellow sitting in front of me in one class, and I won't give his name, but he sat in front of me. And I had known him since the fourth grade. And now here we are, both seniors in high school. And he said to me one day, he said, something's different about you. I said, that's right. He said, well, what is it? I said, I want you to come to church and you'll find out. I didn't know how to tell him how to be saved at that time. He said he didn't think he would, but we kept talking. You know what? One day he did. One day he came to church. One day he got saved. One day he became a deacon in that church. O Lord, open thou my lips. My mouth shall show forth thy praise. Verse 16, for thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. There's sacrifices that God prescribes for us to give. We take offerings here in the church. But you know, that's not going to make us right with God. If I were to come in here and tomorrow, and I would if I could, I promise you that, I'm not in a position to do it. But if I were to come here tomorrow and say, hey, here's $3,000 I want to give to the church. You know what that $3,000 will buy me as far as being right with God? Nothing. Nothing. You don't buy being right with God. Verse 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise. What's a contrite heart? A contrite heart's a heart that feels the need for revival. The contrite heart is the heart that prays like David did and say, I acknowledge my transgression. My sin is always before me. Verse 18, do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with burnt offering, whole burnt offering, and they shall offer bullocks unto thee. What he's saying in that last verse, verse 19, is when we're right with God and we give our offerings, that pleases him. Giving offerings is not going to buy us righteousness, but when we're right and we give our offering, then that pleases God. Because it's given from a heart that loves, and it's given from a heart that's grateful, and it's given from a heart that's right with God. I'll call you to go back to verses 12 and 13, and we're finished tonight. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy free spirit. That's the revival meeting. That's what needs to happen for all of us. When we are back where we used to be, and as close to God as we used to be. What will happen then? 13. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. You know, when people in this world, they're all looking for something. Many are looking for peace. Many are looking for relief. Many are looking for some light, some guidance. People are looking for things. And when they see it, when they see what they're looking for, that attracts them. And that's why we need the revival first. We need to be that kind of attractive. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for blessing us. Thank you for each and every soul who's gathered here this evening. Lord, I look on the outward appearance and I see wonderful people. You look on our hearts. You know what's deep down inside for each and every one of us. And Lord, if there are things that we need to bring before you and confess, let us do so. Let us pour them out for you. Lord, it's not about a public declaration. It's about a heart's commitment to you. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. Then we'll have an influence. Then we'll see people come to trust the Lord. Maybe you're here tonight and say, "Preacher, my heart's right. Best I know my heart, I'm in good fellowship with the Lord." That's wonderful. Praise God. Would you pray that maybe there's some other folks who need to do the same thing? Would you pray that some other folks who know the Lord and they know they're saved, but they're not currently walking closely with Him, that they would come back? That they would confess? That they would get renewed within them a right spirit? And then would you pray for people that you know, maybe somebody in your family, maybe some friends of yours, maybe somebody you work with or a neighbor, would you pray that they would come to trust the Lord Jesus? Preacher, you got anybody particular in mind right now? I do. And I'm guessing that most, if not all of you do as well. Will you pray for them? God, work in me first. And then sinners shall be converted unto thee. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. If God's spoken to your heart, this is your opportunity to respond. You can pray, as we said this morning, right there in your seat. But if you feel led to come forward and pray up front here, you are welcome to do so. If you needed somebody to pray with you, I'll be there. You just do what the Lord's leading you to do while we sing. Father, bless and move this invitation time. We do pray in Jesus' name. Amen.